and accept the good in everything. Broadcasting live on the World Herald Live app or on omaha.com. Good conversations to entertain you, inspire you, and give you the information and ideas needed to create the life you want. This is Conversations with Suzanna.
You are exactly where you need to be. This is Conversations with Suzanna. We're heard on the World Herald Live app. We're also on iTunes, and you can always find us. We are the show that is about empowering you and taking you on a step of understanding and growth so you look a little smarter around the water cooler at the dinner table. You'll have knowledge that others who didn't listen didn't have. So what I want you to be sure and pass the word about the station and pass the word about the shows. And thank God this show goes up on the internet, on iTunes. So once you hear it, you can pass it on and listen to it and call your brothers and sisters across the country and say, listen, I've heard the show. It's all about getting better day at a time. Knowledge is our gift, and this show is about giving you knowledge that you can use. Now, today in the studio, you see I have a couple gents with me, and both of these gents are here to talk about something that I truly, truly loved, Martin Luther King. And the reason I love Martin Luther King is because I am a peaceful soul. I try to be peaceful, even though, you know, you cannot always tell that by family, and you cannot always tell that by my actions, but I choose peace, and that's what I work with the most. I love we're celebrating Martin Luther King because that gentleman changed the way we look at things through peaceful actions. And that is how I want to start the show, by telling you, let's choose peace, everybody. Let's choose peace like Dr. Martin Luther King did. And to talk about Dr. Martin Luther King, I have these two gents in the office. They're from Creighton University. May I tell the wonderful one in the on the far right and the beautiful dreadlocks, how your name?
All right. Peace. My name is Eric Ejiki.
Eric Ejiki.
Yes, ma'am.
And tell me about the dreadlocks. How long have you had them?
The dreadlocks have been a long process. My last haircut was in April 2006.
April 2006. Yeah. Do me a favor. Sweet around. We want to see the dreadlocks. And the reason we want to see the dreadlocks is because it's heritage. Is it correct?
To a degree.
Why do you have dreadlocks? Tell me.
My reason I have dreadlocks, I was going through a change, i.e. a crazy breakup, and I was like, I need to do something. And then E-40 had said he was growing his hair out, so I wanted to grow my hair out, and I've been growing it ever since.
Okay. You know, and what I loved about studying Martin Luther King, he didn't have it easy. I mean, he skipped a couple of school classes. He did a lot of things. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you do good in the world, we just remember the good, and we don't remember the struggle that we do to get to the good. So what is your position at Creighton, young man?
Currently, I'm the program supervisor for the Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality. A lot of what I do is working in the community, so promoting health and doing health programs with, as a part of the community, to better the health of the overall primarily our underserved community members.
Okay. So and how do you do this? Give me a couple hints here.
A couple of programs. One, we have one that we work particularly with some of the churches, primarily in North Omaha, and also the Housing Authority, where we teach proper nutrition and exercise. So it's called Inspiring Change, to change our personal.
It's called, wait.
Inspiring Change.
Yeah, the big words we want to say.
Inspiring Change.
Yeah, baby.
So
okay.
Basically teaching a healthy way of living to help combat chronic disease, which kind of plagues our communities, especially minority communities.
They do.
Yes, ma'am.
Like what?
Heart disease, diabetes, hypertension, especially cancer.
Okay.
All kinds of cancer. They have a higher prevalence in minority
really?
Communities, yes.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that. Yes. I think it's all over the place. I'll be honest with you. I see it everywhere.
It is, but they just have a higher prevalence and sometimes a higher morbidity or mortality rate.
Really? Yeah. Is it because of the lifestyle? Are you teaching them lifestyle skills?
I teach a lot of lifestyle
skills. You could have come to my parents and taught them that, but we'll go on.
I teach some lifestyle skills. There are some different factors, and they're dependent upon kind of how your scope of how you look at it.
Tell me a couple things.
One could be just culture and what you've been acculturated to, either intake or your behavior. So some of the foods that we eat cause a lot of these ailments. What people don't know, I think diabetes, especially type 2 diabetes, mm-hmm. is about 90% preventable. And it's almost particularly based on our actions and what we eat and our amount of activity, physical activity and things like that. So I teach people how to choose things within their scope, different foods. So I don't tell people to go to Whole Foods or stores like that and buy the most expensive vegetables. I tell them if you get frozen, it hasn't been as processed. You can cook it in water so you don't have the salt intake that it would if it was in canned foods.
Marvelous.
And
Marvelous.
Then you can season it the way you want to.
Just between you and me, my favorite store, not to be out there, mm-hmm. is Dollar Tree.
Dollar Tree.
And did you know you can get frozen vegetables in Dollar Tree?
Yes, I do know. They have a lot of them.
Sweet Jesus. I mean, I'm cooking, not the best cook, but I'll throw in those Chinese foods and I look like I'm cooking great. Mm-hmm. So it's not about money. It's about resources. And you offer them the resources to do things.
Yes, I work within anyone's scope. So if you have more monetary resources, we can talk about what you can do. If you have less, we can talk about what you can do to get better and try to prevent some of these ailments.
Marvelous. I almost think that resources, it doesn't matter how much you have, it's what you do with it.
Right.
And so, you know, I like my dollars to sweat. I just so the Dollar Tree is my favorite. But, okay, who are you?
Finally.
Okay, let's go, baby.
I am Mervin Vassar, and I am the Assistant Director for the Health Sciences Multicultural and Community Affairs Department at Creighton University. And one of my primary responsibilities is recruitment and retention as well. And to better explain what it is that we do, and I work directly with Eric Ejiki as well, but our primary mission is about bridging the achievement gap by providing an opportunity for underrepresented students to be exposed to careers in health sciences, as well as to STEM subjects, and we do that through a number of programs and initiatives.
A little slower.
Out of our office.
Okay. So you do this, give me some examples here.
Well, one example is the one that Eric just spoke to you about. The Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality is one of the programs that are run out of our office. We have post-baccalaureate programs, which are for pre-dental and pre-medical students.
Mm-hmm.
So for those students that are traditionally underrepresented in those fields, we provide them with an opportunity to enhance their GPA, enhance their achievement test scores.
So you give them study guides and help them, because a lot of us weren't taught how to study. I wasn't, you know.
Well, that's one of the components, but it's beyond just study guides. It's actually a 13-month intensive program that's heavily focused on sciences. So essentially, we're providing them with the tools in order to be a competitive applicant into professional school. And we work with all of the health sciences schools at Creighton University, which includes the College of Nursing, the School of Pharmacy and Health Professions, the Dental School, as well as the Medical School.
Mm-hmm.
So in addition to that, and then what Eric just spoke of, we also have a number of pipeline programs. We work with the younger generation, introducing them to STEM subjects that they might not have been exposed to, kind of giving them a leg up for those students that eventually want to go into some of these professions.
Marvelous, marvelous. So we're about empowering individuals.
For sure.
We're about empowering individuals. I'm going to ask you, we're going to start with you, Eric. I need to keep a sign of the time. What brought you to Creighton? And what brought you to doing what you're doing?
I'll start with the easy question. What brought me to Creighton? I needed a job. So I was actually, I'm originally from Tyler, Texas.
Texas.
Yes, and I had just finished grad school in Georgia and then couldn't find anything, went back home. So I was searching online. I went on the website. I filled out the application. I got a call while at my graduation for grad school from Creighton.
Wow.
And then set up an interview that next Monday. That Wednesday had to do another interview. which also entailed a mini puppet show.
A mini what? A
puppet show.
Okay, very crucial to interviews. Tell me about
that. Well, one of the programs that I used to run as an intern taught life skills to kindergarten through third graders using puppets and a script. So that was in my resume. So our director, Dr. Kosoko Lasaki, asked me to do a preview of the puppet show. And just so happened, it was a Skype interview. So it was a little toy sitting right on the desk. So I was like, for real? He was laughing hysterically. So I grabbed it and I just went into character for about 12 seconds and did a puppet show. And that might have been what pushed me over the top.
Marvelous. Well, you know, it's all the skills you learn in life.
Right.
You know, all this. I mean, I watched Slumdog Millionaire. Did you ever see that movie?
I didn't.
Everything that he went through helped him win a couple million dollars. So
right.
You never know what you're going to do. So you, and what was your first time up in this area?
When I drove the U-Haul up here to move for the position. And so, got stranded on the side of the road.
Okay, cool.
For about 6-7 hours.
Yeah, that's good. Good. Yeah. And then you got up here. I was stranded on the road 2.5 hours the other day, so I didn't do the long thing, but with the U-Haul. So how long have you been in our Omaha area?
I've been here for almost exactly 2 years.
2 years?
Yes.
Okay. How did you like the first winter?
Well, I'm used to the winters because I went to undergrad at Ohio University.
Oh, so you understand the winters.
I'm pretty familiar with the ice and the snow.
All right. And now we move to you. How long have you two known each other?
We have worked together for approximately 2 years at this point.
You act like you've been together all of your life.
We're just that comfortable.
That is that unity. I hope you have that with me, too.
Okay.
All right, go ahead. Now, tell me exactly how you got here.
Say
your name one more time.
Mervin.
Okay, Mervin.
Mervin.
How did you get here?
That's, I guess, kind of a difficult question for me to say exactly what my career path was, because I've worked in a number of professions. But prior to coming to Creighton University, I actually worked at Bellevue University in undergraduate admissions, so that gave me some exposure to the post-secondary education arena. And I had worked there for about 6 years, so I knew that was a profession that I wanted to stay within, but I wanted to, you know, have more contact with students and be more impactful. So, when this position was presented to me and, you know, I took a chance, applied for the position. And when I came in and met with Dr. Kosoko Lasaki and her staff and learned more about the mission and vision of the organization, it was just something that I really wanted to do. And by the grace of God, I was, selected as the candidate, and here I am 2 years later.
Marvelous. So if we go back to you, what would you say is your biggest triumph at work? What do you, when you, you know, go to bed at night, what do you say? I've done this today. I was good.
I guess first and foremost, as an agent of change, or I guess as a department that really makes a difference in people's lives.
Agent of change is wonderful.
Yeah, I think the work that we do, not only for our students, but in the community, just making a difference in their lives is the, you know, biggest accomplishment that I'm satisfied with each and every day. In addition to, you know, seeing the kids matriculate in a professional school and then...
That word I didn't understand.
Matriculating as in moving on from our program into professional school and then later graduating and going into their professions is, you know, rewarding for us.
Marvelous, marvelous. And tell me about you. And what do you say at the end of the day about your job?
I think just being able to have that real interaction with... the community. A lot of people speak about community as something separate, but I view myself as a part of a community, mainly because one, I live there, I live here, I'm a part of a community, I work in the same community that I live in, and I get to, even through my job, have forced interaction, which also allows me to have personal interaction with individuals and to be able to grow and understand the dynamics of the city and understand the people and be with the people for a change. So it's not, it allows me to take a position where I'm not saying the people, this is more of a we. You know, that's what my job allows me to do, is be a part of the we.
And that was what Martin Luther King was about, wasn't he? He, you know, came up as a child of his grandfather, I believe, was a minister. Is that correct?
I believe so.
I think his father was.
His grandfather was, but One of the stories I read, and you're going to want to use this later, okay, he snuck out of and went to a parade that he wasn't supposed to go to. And so at the parade he wasn't supposed to go to, and his grandmother died at that time. So he was at a very low point and almost tried to commit suicide. And I don't think we know that. I don't think we realize that everyone on the street with two legs goes through a horrible time, and it's what we do with that, how we grow through that. Mm-hmm. So what does, and how long of a time do we have? Do we have 1 minute? When we come back, I'm going to ask you, what has Martin Luther King taught you? What is the lesson you learned from him? And I'm going to ask both of you that. And then we're going to talk about, you know, Gandhi, where he went to India and he studied with Gandhi and he talked the peaceful mission. I just love Martin Luther King, what he represented and what he represents to the world. One man with a lot of strife that he overcame and made the world better with his actions. This is Conversations with Suzanna on the World Herald Live app. You can join us every Wednesday. We have shows that will empower you to a greater vision. We want to get better every day, and we're doing it right here, right now. This is Conversations with Suzanna. We'll be right back. Are exactly where you need to be. This is Conversations with Suzanna, heard on the World Herald Live app. We are here every Wednesday. This show is about empowering you. This show is about giving you knowledge where you can sit by the coffee table and the water and say, you know, I know this. And you can empower others with knowledge. That's what we're all about. That's what we do. And that's why we have these three wonderful gentlemen in the room. Yes, we added another gentleman to the fray. So this is going to be exciting. I'm going to ask you to state your name and your position. Go ahead. You start.
I'm Mervin Vassar, the Assistant Director for HS MECA.
H.S. Mecca, next. Eric, H.S. Mecca, did you say that before?
That was the acronym because the Health Sciences, Multicultural, and Community Affairs Department is sometimes too long to rattle off each and every time.
I want to hear
short,
it.
We call it H.S. Mecca, M-A-C-A.
Okay, go ahead.
Eric Ejiki, Program Supervisor for the Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality, which is inside of H.S. Mecca.
Yes, you got to do it. And you've joined us, young man. And who are you,
please? Yes, I'm Kenneth Allen. I'm pastor of Zion Baptist Church and coordinator of the Martin Luther King Teach-In that's part of the Creighton University sponsored events. And co-hosted by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance.
Marvelous, marvelous. Before we took a break, we were talking about, you know, I did research on Martin Luther King, and we were talking about the what he did coming from not an easy background. You do know he skipped school, too. Did you guys know
yes.
that?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, this is a mortal. This is a mortal who took the power within and made good for a whole bunch of people, which you two gentlemen are doing. But I'm going to ask you a little bit right now, just to give me some ideas of what does Dr. Martin Luther King mean to you? We're going to start with you.
Oh, wow. Oh, man.
And he's watching, so if you're wrong.
I see. Now I'm even more nervous. I have to make sure that I give the correct answer. For me, and that's something sometimes that we kind of overlook and not think about, like even in our daily lives, kind of appreciating the opportunities that we were afforded just by his efforts. So for me, I just have to just stop and realize, you know, where I am today and just capitalize on the opportunities that I've been afforded based on, you know, his efforts. I probably wouldn't be sitting here doing this interview with you if it had not been for him. So,
his efforts and the people who followed him. I just go ahead. I grew up in Martin Luther King's day, so I'm older, and I want to tell you some benefits that I learned. Go ahead.
One thing that I kind of carry with me is through his teachings is more so who he was. So doing what you are called to do, regardless if you know the outcome or not, if you are called to do something under a higher power, you must carry out your mission. You cannot worry about what goes on in this realm, on this earth, and how it affects, but you have to do what you're truly called to do and walk in that with determination and walk in that with faith, 100%.
Wow, we should have started with you. I'm sorry.
Hey,
we should have started with you. Go ahead.
I think what both of these gentlemen have said is right on target. Dr. King is a very personal figure in my life. When he was assassinated, I was 8 years old, and I did not know much about him. But my father is a Baptist pastor, and Dr. King was a Baptist pastor. My father did his graduate work in Atlanta, and when Dr. King was still co-pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, I was born in the South in Little Rock, Arkansas, which is one of the epicenters for the Civil Rights Movement,
right.
The Little Rock Nine Integrated Central High School. Mm-hmm. And so I have a very personal connection with him, and I know that I'm a direct beneficiary of the work that Dr. King did. He made possible the Civil Rights Act, of course, of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act. And as a result of that, all my life I've been able to live where I wanted to live, if I could afford it, vote when I wanted to vote, and go to any school that I wanted to attend if I had the grades.
And you were persistent. I'm a much older lady. And
not much older.
I remember the water hoses turned on people at the
yes.
counter.
Yes.
And I remember saying to my parents, "What's that about?"
Mm-hmm.
How? And I mean, thank God for television.
Yes.
Thank God for the visuals. That I remember the dogs. I remember people holding the dogs, and I thought, "What?" Because I'm only two shades
yes.
away. I don't know if you've
yes.
noticed that. but the other thing that I noticed is he would walk, and people would walk with him, and they would be much like in Gandhi's when he took over India. He was a peaceful warrior. And
he
I
was.
Think by being a peaceful warrior, he did much more than being loud and boisterous and vindictive. How do you handle that?
I agree with that. What made the Dr. King's work different from the work that had preceded him? He was not the first person to be concerned about advancement of Negroes, as we were called in those days. He was not the first. He was not even on the front lines initially, but he actually took it to the streets. Up to that time, the Civil Rights Movement was litigated in the courtrooms of America.
That's what I like, and I think of Wallace. I mean,
yes.
how shameful.
Yes.
But. We grow up with rules, you know. I mean, some Catholics are told not to talk to Protestants. I mean, we all
mm-hmm.
grow up with limitations.
Mm-hmm.
And to have the courage to question your limitations is what really is phenomenal, phenomenal in my book. So tell me what you would like us to know about Martin Luther King.
There is so much to share about him, which is why we have the teach-in. It was birthed out of the notion that although most Americans have heard of Dr. King and even have heard of the speech that he delivered in 1963, what we refer to as the I Have a Dream speech, that there is much more to him. You mentioned earlier the fact that he graduated from high school at a young age. He was only 15.
15,
when he graduated from high school. He skipped two grades. A lot of people don't know that. A lot of people don't know that he was an average college student. He was a BC student in college, but he had a determination, and as a result of that determination and as a result of the vision that he had, even as a young boy, for this country and for his community, Dr. King catapulted himself into the highest ranks of historical figures in America. And I would want people to know that about him, that he was an extraordinary figure, but he planned, he worked. It didn't happen overnight.
I love that he questioned it, too.
Yes.
I love that he had the questions that he was, you know, too often when we see wrong in the world, we don't question it. We don't stand up and say, eh, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the one who would go, eh, what are you doing? he was a forethinker. I mean, his first girlfriend was a white woman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, he did things. I don't know that he saw color.
Mm-hmm.
I think he saw what's right and what's wrong. A human is a human, all under God. I mean, that's what really excites me about Dr. Martin Luther King. Tell me about the day that Creighton is going to be doing. And what is it called again?
It's called the Martin Luther King Teach-In.
Teach-In.
Where we literally teach about Dr. King, and we try to focus on three things. Some aspect of the man, his biography, his life. And his story. And then we look at his message, what he tried to teach and preach and live. After we look at the man and his message, then we also talk about his methods, how he went about doing what he did. Again, a lot of people think that he sprung up from out of nowhere overnight.
Right.
And that the civil rights movement was something that just happened. But it was carefully planned. They strategized. He gathered preachers together and members of the community together. They strategized. They planned. They considered various alternatives. And then they considered how the government would respond and how officials would respond to their efforts and tried to develop some defensive strategies. So they had methods, and we want people to know that. Again, that Dr. King was more than just a man who delivered some wonderful speeches. He was a great orator, to be sure.
Did he write his own speeches?
As far as we know, I've never heard anyone say otherwise.
I read a lot of Conversations with Suzanna is heard on the World Herald Live. I must tell you, the show off the air is just as exciting as on the air. We're talking, where do we go from here? There's so much about Dr. Luther King that we need to celebrate his life and his legacy, which is about peaceful terms, peaceful understanding. And one of the things that I love, and I love the fact that the understanding that, you know, when I saw the water hitting people, they were people.
They were.
And you know, when we're growing up, we're thinking we have different classes. We put everybody in. This is a Muslim. This is a Christian. And we don't see the uniqueness of every individual in the capacity. And I'm going to let you start, Doctor. Tell me what you think you want us to know, Reverend Kenneth, about Martin Luther King. What is the thing that means the most to you?
I think the thing that means the most to me is that he's a prime example of preparation and timing. He was intending to be a local pastor in Montgomery, Alabama, finish his dissertation, which he did, finish his dissertation, and live a quiet life as a local congregational leader. But then fate intervened, and I would say more specifically, God intervened.
Yeah,
and Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on a bus in Montgomery, and out of that they launched the Montgomery bus boycott. And after the boycott,
which was brilliant in itself,
absolutely
brilliant.
It
I mean, he did not go throw things at the buses.
No,
he just said you walk. Mm-hmm. I mean, brilliant. I wouldn't do it, but I'm not that mm-hmm. courageous. But that was just brilliant. His whole aspect of being, you don't want this. You don't get our money.
And you say you wouldn't have done it, but when given the right circumstances and the right inspiration, one never knows what one might do, because
that's
I think
exactly
there were people
right.
who ordinarily would not have done that. But because of the strong leadership that he provided, along with the ministers and other community leaders.
And the motivation.
They were motivated to do that.
I mean, and it's to motivate Adele. What would you talked about earlier that what you learned from Marten was, go through it one more time, because it was profound.
What I had said earlier was walking in your mission and not questioning your mission. Make sure you have an understanding of what you are placed on this earth to do.
How is it that we find our mission, though? I mean, how do we not question our mission? I think that's probably something you're going to handle, Reverend. How is it that we don't know our mission, can understand the mission that he brought up, that we're here to do?
Well, I think Eric is right on target with that. Finding your mission in life is your primary goal in life, understanding who you are and being authentic and true to who you are and to your calling. And each of us has a calling. It's not just those of us who are in the ministry, so to speak, mm-hmm. but everyone has a calling. I'm going to be delivering a speech in the next few days on that very issue. It's almost as if Eric saw my notes because I'm talking about the incredibly heavy burden of being yourself, of just being true to who you are. And so we go about that through a process of prayer and honestly interrogating our lives.
Questioning our lives.
Absolutely.
Questioning your lives, yes. For the greater good. Mm-hmm. I mean, and tell me what youth believe that they have been talking about.
I guess, well, to your first question about Dr. King, and I guess what I want people to kind of take from that, or what I take from that personally, is just that I think everybody has the ability to, you know, transform and make a difference in some capacity. And with regards to, you were talking about knowing, like, your passion and, mm-hmm. and know what it is that you're called to do. I mean, for me and my personal experiences, I just think, for one, it's going to take a time and then a series of events. And that could be, you know, trial and error, ups and downs, highs and lows. And then I think you then find, you know, like a happy medium through all of those experiences in life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Dr. Martin Luther King is a great example of that. We all have the power to be better. We all have the power to help others. Can you give us a quick rundown of what's going on at the campus?
Oh, definitely. Each year, Creighton University celebrates the life and legacy of Dr. King through a series of events, and typically those events are centered around his principles of nonviolence.
Love that nonviolence things.
Right.
Okay.
And this year's principle is nonviolence holds that voluntary suffering can educate and transform. And as Pastor Allen pointed out, the first kickoff to our events will be the teach-in on Saturday, January 16th, and that's going to be from 1 to 5 at the Creighton School of Law. So,
okay.
That event is open to the community, and you can go to Creighton's website. I believe it's /about/MLK, and you can see a series of events, which includes a viewing of the movie on the 17th. We have Courageous Voices, which is a discussion forum on Monday, January 18th. We then have a recognition and award ceremony, which is also the evening of Monday, January 18th as well.
And I do want everyone to understand that Dr. Martin Luther King is a gift to all of us. No matter what color your skin is, we all can learn from him and what he taught us. We'll be right back. This is Conversations with Suzanna, heard on the World Herald Live app and at omaha.com/Suzanna. are exactly where you need to be. This has been a very exciting show, and if you're online watching it, you'll see the characters in the studio changed. Oh, yes, we're always constantly changing, constantly moving about, because this show is about giving you all the information you could possibly need. And we're going to start with the girl on the right. We have between us, if you'll introduce yourself first, Reverend, your name is?
Yes, I'm Kenneth Allen, pastor of Zion Baptist Church in North Omaha, 22nd and Grant Street.
Okay, and you're?
I'm Andrea Kasniak, or the paper.
Okay, and what do you do for the paper, Andrea?
For nightlife mostly, but I also do community events and stuff like that.
Okay, marvelous. And Andrea, and how long have you worked for the paper?
Almost 3 years.
3 years, and what did you do before you wrote for the Omaha World-Herald?
I went to college.
You went to college?
My first job, yeah.
Your first job.
Mm-hmm.
And your job is to scope the town, see what's happening, and move through that. There. You're here to tell us what's happening on Martin Luther King Day.
Yeah, we have a list of events that we're running.
Okay, let's talk about that.
Okay, what do you want to know?
Tell us everything that's going to be happening.
It's a really long list. So Creighton is having...
Well, we've talked to Creighton. So,
I don't know who you've talked to. So Creighton's having a thing. There's a lot of church things.
Tell me about the church things.
Well, St. Matthew Lutheran is having a thing on Sunday to honor Martin Luther King. I guess they're going to feature music by Duke Ellington during their 10:30 a.m. service.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also going to be music from their director and their soloist. So that's something that we're featuring. They're going to show Selma at Creighton at 7. So I guess you already know that. And then Salem Baptist is having a Martin Luther King service at 6.
And actually, that's sponsored by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance.
Tell us who that's sponsored by, baby.
That's sponsored by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance. We refer to it as the IMA. And the IMA is composed of pastors and clergy from various denominations, Lutherans, Roman Catholics, Baptists.
So it's not by the color of your skin that you're there.
Not by the color of your skin. It is a fully integrated group.
It's by the color of your heart.
That's right, and the content of your character.
That's exactly right. What else do we have, Andrea?
There's an event at House of Loom, which is actually, it's like a bar and nightclub on Saturday, which seems really cool. It's going to be a tribute to Martin Luther King, and they're going to have poetry by Michelle Troxclair, who does lots of, she does like Verbal Gumbo, which is a poetry event for them. And her poetry is going to be inspired by Coretta King. Martin Luther King's wife. And there's also going to be music performances. Derek Higgins is going to be there. Stuff like that. So it's just going to be a full night of celebrations. And I think it starts at 8 and runs till 2 a.m.
Now, is there a place in the paper we can go to see all of these lists?
So Go is a resource, and that's in Thursday in the paper.
Thursday.
Yeah, and then Community Connection. Well, it's Good News now, sorry. And we have the Good News section, which is, so we have church notes, community events, things like that go in there.
Okay, so you'll want to check the Omaha World Herald.
Yes, you will.
For Thursday.
And our big list of Martin Luther King events, I believe, is running this Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I want to thank you for coming in.
Yeah.
And then we're going to go back to you, Reverend.
Okay.
And I'm going to let you end up the show and telling us what you want us to experience from Martin Luther King.
That is a wonderful question. I want us to experience the man in his greatness, but also in his complexity. He's not a cardboard figure. He has a unique position in America. He's the only person other than a United States president who has a holiday set aside in his honor.
And a Nobel Prize. No, what is it? A Nobel?
Nobel Peace Prize.
Nobel Peace Prize.
Yes, indeed.
And that was quite an accomplishment in his day and age.
Yes, it was. He was one of the youngest ever to receive a Nobel Prize. And it was a remarkable accomplishment because he was not an office holder. He did not have a position at one of the great universities in the world. He was a man who was committed and dedicated to his cause and to his mission, and that propelled him into the front ranks of world history.
Marvelous, marvelous. The Martin Luther King Day is going to be January 15th, is that correct? Is that his birthday?
That's his actual birthday, but the annual holiday is the third Monday in January. Every year it's the third Monday in January.
Why is it the third Monday and not his birthday?
It's not on his birthday because Congress chose to make it a day that could be celebrated in conjunction with a free weekend, and as they do with Memorial Day and a number of other holidays.
So I would suggest that everyone needs to get involved and take a look and see what is there for us on Martin Luther King Day. This day is a day of inspiration, and what I want to take for you is the inspiration of Dr. Martin Luther King. And what is it you do at your church? Tell me about the name of the church again. What does Zion mean? I don't know what Zion means.
Zion Baptist Church is the name of the church, and Zion was a biblical name for Jerusalem. The mountain on which Jerusalem was located was Mount Zion. So in virtually every community in America of any size, you will find either a Zion Baptist Church or a Mount Zion Baptist Church. Both of them were interchangeable with the name, the city of Jerusalem.
Well, and I'll be honest with you, when I hear Zion, I think Jew.
Yes.
And Christ was
a
Jew.
Yes.
So, okay,
it all falls
together now. Thank you for being here.
Does. May I say something?
Yes.
I just want to say thank you, Suzanna, for having us on today to talk about the Martin Luther King events.
It's a beautiful.
And to share this. Thank you.
I mean, I'm so proud of his courage. I pray that we all have courage to be our best and not harm each other.
Yes.
Andrea, I'm going to have you back in the studio because you got great lipstick on.
Thank you.
Again, this is Conversations with Suzanna. We're heard every Wednesday on the World Herald Live app. We are here about empowering you, helping you see things that you haven't seen before, understand things you haven't understood. Come join us next Wednesday.
There are many sounds in your daily life. Ones that make you smile. Ones that help you relax. And there are some sounds that can help save lives. Wireless emergency alerts. Now on many mobile devices, use a unique sound and vibration to bring you critical information about emergencies in your area. With updates from local sources you know and trust, you can be in the know wherever you are. Learn more at ready.gov/alerts. Brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
It takes 12 years to create a graduate. It takes about the same time to create a dropout. The difference between a child becoming one or the other could be you. Studies prove that reading to a child regularly dramatically improves reading skills. And kids who read well by third grade are 4 times as likely to graduate. So United Way is calling for 1 million volunteers over the next 3 years. We're asking you to step up, make a pledge, tutor a child who needs help, mentor a kid who needs someone on their side. Volunteer to read to children. Make a difference. Because when a child advances, we all advance. Entire communities improve. The path to success or failure starts long before graduation day. And the difference between a graduate and a dropout could be you. Be a reader, tutor, or mentor. Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United. Take the pledge. Go to liveunited.org now. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
When I grow up, I want to be a new pair of blue jeans.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's first computer.
When I grow up, I want to be a glass countertop in a new home.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's best birthday present.
When I grow up, I want to be a football stadium.
When I grow up, I want to be a warm place on a cold day.
When I grow up, I want to be a fancy
bike. When I grow up, I want to be a bike that races around the country.
When I grow up, I want to be a bench on a forest trail.
I want to be a rocking chair on a sunny porch.
I want to be a skyscraper.
I want to be a...
I want to be a...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
When I grow up, I don't want to be a piece of garbage.
And if you recycle me, I won't be.
Give your garbage another life. Recycle. Learn how at iwanttoberecycled.org. A public service advertisement brought to you by Keep America Beautiful and the Ad Council.
Go, Caleb! Come on, hit a homer, Jesse!
Let's go, guys!
Hey, did you guys know that kids who play sports earn more money when they grow up?
Of course. I knew that.
Hey, did you guys know that kids who read books have a bigger vocabulary?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Wow, jinx. Did you guys know that friendly children have more friends?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's true. I knew that. Did you guys know that winter babies are better at music?
Everyone knows that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, pretty obvious.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. Obvious. Oh, hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
Huh, I didn't know that.
I'm pretty sure I knew that.
I'm pretty sure you didn't.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
I think someone at my friend's school has this thing called autism. My friend's brother's son has autism. My neighbor's son has autism. My son has autism.
Autism is getting closer to home. Today, 1 in 110 children is diagnosed with autism. That's a 600% increase in the last 20 years. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
I heard on the news about that 5-year-old who found his uncle's gun. The kid didn't know it was loaded.
I heard on the news about that 14-year-old girl who was bullied online. For like a year, she couldn't take it anymore, so she got her dad's gun from his nightstand.
I heard on the news about that guy who broke into someone's house, stole a gun from the hall closet.
He accidentally shot his cousin in the head.
She killed herself.
And later, killed the owner of the store he was trying to rob.
If you own a gun, you have a full-time responsibility. When you aren't using it, be sure it can't get into the hands of curious children, troubled teenagers, a thief, or anyone else who might misuse it. Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org. This message brought to you by the National Crime Prevention Council, the Bureau of Justice Assistance, and the Ad Council.
My name is Charles.
My name is Charles.
One day I had a sudden headache.
I had a headache.
My arm went numb and I felt confused.
My arm went tingly.
I was having a stroke. My wife dialed 911.
I had a stroke on the bus.
Seconds made all the difference.
If you or someone you know has any of these symptoms, don't wait. Call 911.
Time lost is brain lost.
For more information, visit powertoendstroke.org. Brought to you by the American Heart Association, American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
Conversations with Suzanna, empowering you to look for and accept the good in everything. Broadcasting live on the World Herald Live app or on omaha.com. Good conversations to entertain you, inspire you, and give you the information and ideas needed to create the life you want. This is Conversations with Suzanna.
You are exactly where you need to be. This is Conversations with Suzanna. We're heard on the World Herald Live app. We're also on iTunes, and you can always find us. We are the show that is about empowering you and taking you on a step of understanding and growth so you look a little smarter around the water cooler at the dinner table. You'll have knowledge that others who didn't listen didn't have. So what I want you to be sure and pass the word about this station and pass the word about the shows. And thank God this show goes up on the internet, on iTunes. So once you hear it, you can pass it on and listen to it and call your brothers and sisters across the country and say, listen, I've heard the show. It's all about getting better day at a time. Knowledge is our gift, and this show is about giving you knowledge that you can use. Now, today in the studio, you see I have a couple gents with me, and both of these gents are here to talk about something that I truly loved, Martin Luther King. And the reason I love Martin Luther King is because I am a peaceful soul. I try to be peaceful, even though, you know, you cannot always tell that by family, and you cannot always tell that by my actions, but I choose peace, and that's what I work with the most. I love we're celebrating Martin Luther King, because that gentleman changed the way we look at things through peaceful actions, and that is how I want to start the show, by telling you, let's choose peace, everybody. Let's choose peace like Dr. Martin Luther King did. And to talk about Dr. Martin Luther King, I have these two gents in the office. They're from Creighton University. May I tell the wonderful one in the on the far right and the beautiful dreadlocks how your name?
All right. Peace. My name is Eric Ejiki.
Eric Ejiki.
Yes, ma'am.
And tell me about the dreadlocks. How long have you had them?
The dreadlocks have been a long process. My last haircut was in April 2006.
Yeah. Do me a favor. Sweet them on. We want to see the dreadlocks. And the reason we want to see the dreadlocks is because it's heritage. Is it correct?
To a degree.
Why do you have dreadlocks? Tell me.
My reason I have dreadlocks, I was going through a change, i.e. a crazy breakup, and I was like, I need to do something. And then E40 had said he was growing his hair out, so I wanted to grow my hair out, and I've been growing it ever since.
Okay. You know, and what I loved about studying Martin Luther King, he didn't have it easy. I mean, he skipped a couple of school classes. He did a lot of things. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when you do good in the world, we just remember the good. And we don't remember the struggle that we do to get to the good. So what is your position at Creighton, young man?
Currently, I'm the program supervisor for the Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality. A lot of what I do is working in the community, so promoting health and doing health programs with as a part of the community to better the health of the overall, primarily our underserved community members.
Okay. So... And how do you do this? Give me a couple hints here.
A couple of programs. One we have, one that we work particularly with some of the churches, primarily in North Omaha, and also the Housing Authority, where we teach proper nutrition and exercise. So it's called Inspiring Change, to change our personal...
It's called, wait.
Inspiring Change.
Yeah, the big words we want to say.
Inspiring Change.
Yeah, baby.
So,
okay.
Basically teaching a healthy way of living to help combat chronic disease, which kind of plagues our communities, especially minority communities. Yes, ma'am.
Like what?
Heart disease, diabetes, hypertension, especially cancer.
Okay.
All kinds of cancer. They have a higher prevalence in minority communities, yes.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I think it's all over the place. I'll be honest with you. I see it everywhere.
It is, but they just have a higher prevalence and sometimes a higher morbidity or mortality rate.
Really? Yeah. Is it because of the lifestyle? Are you teaching them lifestyle skills?
I teach a lot of lifestyle
skills. You could have come to my parents and taught them that, but we'll go on.
I teach some lifestyle skills. There are some different factors, and they're dependent upon kind of your scope of how you look at it.
Tell me a couple things.
One could be just culture and what you've been acculturated to, either intake or your behavior. So some of the foods that we eat cause a lot of these ailments. What people don't know, I think diabetes, especially type 2 diabetes, mm-hmm. is about 90% preventable. And it's almost particularly based on our actions and what we eat and our amount of activity, physical activity and things like that. So I teach people how to choose things within their scope, different foods. So I don't tell people to go to Whole Foods or stores like that and buy the most expensive vegetables. I tell them if you get frozen, it hasn't been as processed. You can cook it in water so you don't have the salt intake that it would if it was in canned foods.
Marvelous.
And then you can season it the way you want to.
Just between you and me, my favorite store, not to be out there,
mm-hmm.
is Dollar Tree.
Dollar Tree.
And did you know you can get frozen vegetables at Dollar Tree?
Yes, I do know. They have a lot of them.
Sweet Jesus. I mean, I'm cooking, not the best cook, but I'll throw in those Chinese foods and I look like I'm cooking great. Mm-hmm. So it's not about money. It's about resources. And right. You offer them the resources to do things.
Yes, I work within anyone's scope. So if you have more monetary resources, we can talk about what you can do. If you have less, we can talk about what you can do to get better and try to prevent some of these ailments.
Marvelous. I almost think that resources, it doesn't matter how much you have. Mm-hmm. It's what you do with it.
Right.
And so, you know, I like my dollars to sweat. I just so the dollar tree is my favorite. But, okay, who are you?
Finally.
Okay, let's go, baby.
I am Mervyn Vassar, and I am the Assistant Director for the Health Sciences Multicultural and Community Affairs Department at Creighton University. And one of my primary responsibilities is recruitment and retention as well. And to better explain what it is that we do, and I work directly with Eric Ejiki as well, but our primary mission is about bridging the achievement gap by providing an opportunity for underrepresented students to be exposed to careers in health sciences, as well as to STEM subjects, and we do that through a number of programs and initiatives.
A little slower.
Out of our office.
Okay. So you do this, give me some examples here.
Well, one example is the one that Eric just spoke to you about. The Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality is one of the programs that are run out of our office. We have post-baccalaureate programs, which are for pre-dental and pre-medical students.
Mm-hmm.
So for those students that are traditionally underrepresented in those fields, we provide them with an opportunity to enhance their GPA, enhance their achievement test scores.
So you give them study guides and help them, because a lot of us weren't taught how to study. I wasn't, you know.
Well, that's one of the components, but it's beyond just study guides. It's actually a 13-month intensive program that's heavily focused on sciences. So essentially, we're providing them with the tools in order to be a competitive applicant into professional school. And we work with all of the health sciences schools at Creighton University, which includes the College of Nursing, the School of Pharmacy and Health Professions, the Dental School, as well as the Medical School.
Mm-hmm.
So in addition to that, and then what Eric just spoke of, we also have a number of pipeline programs where we work with the younger generation, introducing them to STEM subjects that they might not have been exposed to, kind of giving them a leg up for those students that eventually want to go into some of these professions.
Marvelous. So we're about empowering individuals.
For sure.
We're about empowering individuals. I'm going to ask you, we're going to start with you, Eric. I need to keep a sign of the time. What brought you to Creighton? And what brought you to doing what you're doing?
I'll start with the easy question. What brought me to Creighton? I needed a job. So I was actually, I'm originally from Tyler, Texas.
Texas.
Yes, and I had just finished grad school in Georgia and then couldn't find anything, went back home.
Uh-huh.
So I was searching online. I went on the website. I filled out the application. I got a call while at my graduation for grad school from Creighton.
Wow.
And then set up an interview that next Monday. That Wednesday had to do another interview, which also entailed a mini puppet show.
A mini what? A
puppet show.
Okay, very crucial, the interviews. Tell me about
yes.
that.
Yes. Well, one of the programs that I used to run as an intern taught life skills to kindergarten through third graders using puppets and a script. So
wow.
That was in my resume. So our director, Dr. Kosoko Lasaki, asked me to do a preview of the puppet show, and just so happened it was a Skype interview, so it was a little toy sitting right on the desk. So I was like, for real? He was laughing hysterically. So I grabbed it and I just went into character for about 12 seconds and did a puppet show, and that might have been what pushed me over the top.
Yep. Marvelous. Well, you know, it's all the skills you learn in life.
Right.
You know, all the I mean, I watched Slumdog Millionaire. Did you ever see that movie?
I didn't.
Everything that he went through helped him win a couple million dollars. So
right.
You never know what you're going to do. So you, and what was your first time up in this area?
When I drove the U-Haul up here to move for the position and got stranded on the side of the road.
Okay, cool.
For about 6-7 hours.
Yeah, that's good. Good. Yeah. Would you, and then you got up here. I was stranded on the road 2.5 hours the other day, so I didn't do the long thing, but with the U-Haul. So how long have you been in our Omaha area?
I've been here for almost exactly 2 years.
2 years?
Yes.
Okay. How did you like the first winter?
Well, I'm used to the winters because I went to undergrad at Ohio University.
Oh, so you understand the winters.
I'm pretty familiar with the ice and the snow.
All right. All right. And now we move to you. How long have you two known each other?
We have worked together for approximately 2 years at this point.
You act like you've been together all of your life. There is
We're just that,
that
comfortable. We're just that comfortable.
That is that unity. I hope you have that with me, too.
Okay.
All right, go ahead. Now, tell me exactly how you got here.
Say
your name one more time.
Mervin.
Okay, Mervin.
Mervin.
How did you get here?
That's, I guess, kind of a difficult question for me to say exactly what my career path was, because I've worked in a number of professions. But prior to coming to Creighton University, I actually worked at Bellevue University in undergraduate admissions, so that gave me some exposure to the post-secondary education arena. And I had worked there for about 6 years, so I knew that that was a profession that I wanted to stay within, but I wanted to, you know, have more contact with students and be more impactful. So when this position was presented to me, and, you know, I took a chance, applied for the position, and when I came in and met with Dr. Kosoko Lasaki and her staff and learned more about the mission and vision of the organization, it was just something that I really wanted to do. And by the grace of God, I was selected as a candidate, and here I am 2 years later.
Marvelous. So if we go back to you, what would you say is your biggest triumph at work? What do you, when you, you know, go to bed at night, what do you say? I've done this today. I was good.
I guess first and foremost, as an agent of change, or I guess as a department that really makes a difference in people's lives. Yeah, I think the work that we do, not only for our students, but in the community, just making a difference in their lives is the, you know, biggest accomplishment that I'm satisfied with each and every day. In addition to, you know, seeing the kids matriculate in a professional school and then...
That word I didn't understand.
I'm sorry, matriculating as in moving on from our program into professional school and then later graduating and going into their professions is, you know, rewarding for us.
Marvelous, marvelous. And tell me about you, and what do you say at the end of the day about your job?
I think just being able to have that real interaction with... the community. A lot of people speak about community as something separate, but I view myself as a part of a community, mainly because, one, I live there. I live here. I'm a part of a community. I work in the same community that I live in, and I get to, even through my job, have forced interaction, which also allows me to have personal interaction with individuals and to be able to grow and understand the dynamics of the city and understand the people and be with the people for a change. So it's not, it allows me to take a position where I'm not saying the people, this is more of a we. You know, that's what my job allows me to do, is be a part of
we. And that was what Martin Luther King was about, wasn't he? He, you know, came up as a child of his grandfather, I believe, was a minister. Is that correct?
His grandfather
was dealt, but one of the stories I read, and you're going to want to use this later, okay, he snuck out of and went to a parade that he wasn't supposed to go to, and so at the parade he wasn't supposed to go to, and his grandmother died at that time. So he was at a very low point and almost tried to commit suicide. And I don't think we know that. I don't think we realize that everyone on the street with two legs goes through a horrible time, and it's what we do with that, how we grow through that. Mm-hmm. So what does, and how long of a time do we have? Do we have 1 minute? When we come back, I'm going to ask you, what has Martin Luther King taught you? What is the lesson you learned from him? And I'm going to ask both of you that. And then we're going to talk about, you know, Gandhi, where he went to India and he studied with Gandhi and he talked the peaceful mission. I just love Martin Luther King, what he represented and what he represents to the world. One man with a lot of strife that he overcame and made the world better with his actions. This is Conversations with Suzanna on the World Herald Live app. You can join us every Wednesday. We have shows that will empower you to a greater vision. We want to get better every day, and we're doing it right here, right now. This is Conversations with Suzanna. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Teresa Elliott with the Elliott Company and Berkshire Hathaway Home Services Real Estate. And I'm excited to be sponsoring Conversations with Suzanna, a show that will connect you with the tools you can use to live your life in peace and harmony. Simply go to ElliottOmaha.com and click on Life Tools for empowering ideas to live your life with purpose and harmony.
When I grow up, I want to be a new pair of blue jeans.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's first computer.
When I grow up, I want to be a glass countertop in a new home.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's best birthday present.
When I grow up, I want to be a football stadium.
When I grow up, I want to be a warm fleece on a cold day.
When I grow up, I want to be a fancy
backslash. When I grow up, I want to be a bike that races around the
country. When I grow up, I want to be a bench on a forest trail.
When I grow up, I want to be a rocking chair on a sunny porch.
I want to be a skyscraper.
I want to be a...
I want to be a...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
When I grow up, I don't want to be a piece of garbage. And if you recycle me, I won't be.
Give your garbage another life. Recycle. Learn how at iwanttoberecycled.org. A public service advertisement brought to you by Keep America Beautiful and the Ad Council.
The traditional light bulb, a groundbreaking invention in 1879. It's time we switch to longer-lasting Energy Star light bulbs. They're more efficient than the old bulbs, like a text message is more efficient than a carrier pigeon. And they cut down on our energy costs. Because in our own groundbreaking age, we deserve a light bulb that saves us some cash. Saving energy saves you money. Learn more at EnergySavers.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Energy and the Ad Council.
When I grow up, I want to be a new pair of blue jeans.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's first computer.
When I grow up, I want to be a glass countertop in a new home.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's best birthday present.
When I grow up, I want to be a football stadium.
When I grow up, I want to be a warm fleece on a cold day.
When I grow up, I want to be a fancy
backslash.
When I grow
up,
I want to be a bike that races around the
country. When I grow up, I want to be a bench on a forest trail.
I want to be a rocking chair on a sunny porch.
I want to be a skyscraper.
I want to be a...
I want to be a...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
When I grow up, I don't want to be a piece of garbage. And if you recycle me, I won't be.
Give your garbage another life. Recycle. Learn how at iwanttoberecycled.org. A public service advertisement brought to you by Keep America Beautiful and the Ad Council.
When I grow up, I want to be a new pair of blue jeans.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's first computer.
When I grow up, I want to be a glass countertop in a new home.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's best birthday present.
When I grow up, I want to be a football stadium.
When I grow up, I want to be a warm place on a cold day.
When I grow up, I want to be a fancy
backslash.
When
I grow up,
I want to be a bike that races around the
country. When I grow up, I want to be a bench on a forest trail.
I want to be a rocking chair on a sunny porch.
I want to be a skyscraper.
I want to be a...
I want to be a...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
I want to be...
When I grow up, I don't want to be a piece of garbage. And if you recycle me, I won't be.
Give your garbage another life. Recycle. Learn how at iwanttoberecycled.org. A public service advertisement brought to you by Keep America Beautiful and...
There are many sounds in your daily life. Ones that make you smile. Ones that help you relax. And there are some sounds that can help save lives. Wireless emergency alerts, now on many mobile devices, use a unique sound and vibration to bring you critical information about emergencies in your area. With updates from local sources you know and trust, you can be in the know wherever you are. Learn more at ready.gov/alerts. Brought to you by FEMA and the Ad Council.
You are exactly where you need to be. This is Conversations with Suzanna. Heard on the World Herald Live app. We are here every Wednesday. This show is about empowering you. This show is about giving you knowledge where you can sit by the coffee table and the water and say, you know, I know this. And you can empower others with knowledge. That's what we're all about. That's what we do. And that's why we have these three wonderful gentlemen in the room. Yes, we added another gentleman to the fray. So This is going to be exciting. I'm going to ask you to state your name and your position. Go ahead. You start.
I'm Mervin Vassar, the Assistant Director for HS Mecca.
HS Mecca. Next. Eric, HS Mecca? Did you say that before?
That was the acronym because the Health Sciences, Multicultural, and Community Affairs Department is sometimes too long to rattle off each and every time.
I want to hear
short,
it.
We call it HS Mecca, M-A-C-A.
Okay. Go ahead.
Eric Ujiki, Program Supervisor for the Center for Promoting Health and Health Equality, which is inside of HS Mecca.
Yes, you got to do it. And you've joined us, young man, and who are you?
Yes, I'm Kenneth Allen. I'm pastor of Zion Baptist Church and coordinator of the Martin Luther King Teach-In that's part of the Creighton University sponsored events and co-hosted by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance.
Marvelous, marvelous. Before we took a break, we were talking about, you know, I did research on Martin Luther King, and we were talking about the what he did, coming from not an easy background. You do know he skipped school, too. Did you guys know
yes,
that?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, this is a mortal. Mm-hmm. This is a mortal who took the power within and made mm-hmm. good for a whole bunch of people, which you two gentlemen are doing. But I'm going to ask you a little bit right now, just to give me some ideas of what does Dr. Martin Luther King mean to you? We're going to start with you.
Oh, wow. Oh, man.
And he's watching, so if you're wrong.
I see. Now I'm even more nervous. I have to make sure that I give the correct answer. For me, and that's something sometimes that we kind of overlook and not think about, like even in our daily lives, kind of appreciating the opportunities that we were afforded just by his efforts. So for me, I just have to just stop and realize, you know, where I am today and just capitalize on the opportunities that I've been afforded based on, you know, his efforts. I probably wouldn't be sitting here doing this interview with you if it had not been for him. So
his efforts and the people who followed him. I just go ahead. I grew up in Martin Luther King's day, so I'm older, mm-hmm. and I want to tell you some benefits that I learned. Go ahead.
One thing that I kind of carry with me is through his teachings is more so who he was. So doing what you are called to do, regardless if you know the outcome or not, if you are called to do something under a higher power, you must carry out your mission. You cannot worry about what goes on in this realm, on this earth, and how it affects, but you have to do what you're truly called to do and walk in that with determination and walk in that with faith, 100%.
Wow, we should have started with you. I'm sorry.
Hey,
we should have started with you. Go ahead.
I think what both of these gentlemen have said is right on target. Dr. King is a very personal figure in my life. When he was assassinated, I was 8 years old, and I did not know much about him. But my father is a Baptist pastor, and Dr. King was a Baptist pastor. My father did his graduate work in Atlanta. And when Dr. King was still co-pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, I was born in the South in Little Rock, Arkansas, which is one of the epicenters for the civil rights movement,
right.
The Little Rock Nine Integrated Central High School. Mm-hmm. And so I have a very personal connection with him, and I know that I'm a direct beneficiary of the work that Dr. King did. He made possible the Civil Rights Act, of course, of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act, and as a result of that, all my life I've been able to live where I wanted to live if I could afford it, vote when I wanted to vote, and go to any school that I wanted to attend if I had the grades.
And you were persistent. I'm a much older lady, and
I'm much older.
I remember the water hoses turned on people at the
yes.
tunnel.
Yes.
And I remember saying to my parents, "What's that about?"
Mm-hmm.
Thank God for television.
Yes.
Thank God for the visuals. I remember the dogs. I remember people holding the dogs. And I thought, what? Because I'm only two shades yes. away. I don't know if you've yes. noticed that. but the other thing that I noticed is he would walk. And people would walk with him. And they would be much like in Gandhi's when he took over India. He was a peaceful warrior. And I think by being a peaceful warrior, he did much more than being loud and boisterous and vindictive. How do you handle that?
I agree with that. What made the Dr. King's work different from the work that had preceded him? He was not the first person to be concerned about advancement of Negroes, as we were called in those days. He was not the first. He was not even on the front lines initially, but he actually took it to the streets. Up to that time, the civil rights movement was litigated in the courtrooms of America.
That's what I like, and I think of Wallace. I mean, yes. How shameful.
Yes.
But we grow up with rules, you know. I mean, some Catholics are told not to talk to Protestants. I mean, we all mm-hmm. grow up with limitations,
mm-hmm.
and to have the courage to question your limitations is what really is phenomenal in my book. So tell me what you would like us to know about Martin Luther King.
There is so much to share about him, which is why we have the teach-in. It was birthed out of the notion that although most Americans have heard of Dr. King and even have heard of the speech that he delivered in 1963, what we refer to as the I Have a Dream speech, that there is much more to him. You mentioned earlier the fact that he graduated from high school at a young age. He was only 15.
15?
When he graduated
yes.
from high school. He skipped two grades. A lot of people don't know that. A lot of people don't know that he was an average college student. He was a BC student in college. But he had a determination, and as a result of that determination, and as a result of the vision that he had, even as a young boy, for this country and for his community, Dr. King catapulted himself into the highest ranks of historical figures in America. And I would want people to know that about him, that he was an extraordinary figure, but he planned, he worked. It didn't happen overnight.
I love that he questioned it, too.
Yes.
I love that he had the questions, that he was, you know, too often when we see wrong in the world, we don't question it. We don't stand up and say, eh, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the one who would go, eh, what are you doing? he was a forethinker. I mean, his first girlfriend was a white woman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, he did things. I don't know that he saw color.
Mm-hmm.
I think he saw what's right and what's wrong. A human is a human, all under God. I mean, that's what really excites me about Dr. Martin Luther King. Tell me about the day that Creighton is going to be doing. And what is it called?
It's called the Martin Luther King Teach-In.
Teach-In.
Where we literally teach about Dr. King, and we try to focus on three things. Some aspect of the man, his biography, his life, and his story. And then we look at his message, what he tried to teach and preach and live. After we look at the man and his message, then we also talk about his methods, how he went about doing what he did. Again, a lot of people think that he sprung up from out of nowhere overnight.
Right.
And that the civil rights movement was something that just happened. But it was carefully planned. They strategized. He gathered preachers together and members of the community together. They strategized. They planned. They considered various alternatives, and then they considered how the government would respond and how officials would respond to their efforts, and tried to develop some defensive strategies. So they had methods, and we want people to know that. Again, that Dr. King was more than just a man who delivered some wonderful speeches. He was a great orator, to be sure.
Did he write his own speeches?
As far as we know, I've never heard anyone say otherwise.
I read a lot of other things, but I didn't. And I love that he can. And I think the problem is that most of us walking on two legs don't realize, are we having a voice? Is that music? Time to take a break already? We're taking a break already. But mm-hmm. I think the thing is that we're all mortal. And it's what we do with our mortality for the others. I love what you said. That was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
About making raising each other up. And that's what we're all about here. This is Conversations with Suzanna, heard on the World Herald Live app. We're also on omaha.com/Suzanna, where you'll see the pictures of the fine three men that I have here in the studio. We'll be right back.
Take a look under your bed. Find stuff under there? What about jobs? No? Now try your basement. There's a pair of overalls that, overall, you're not so into anymore. A perfectly good laptop that hasn't seen your lap in months. And even more stuff. But still no jobs? Well, you really have both. See, stuff is defined as household articles considered as a group. Sometimes this stuff is no longer needed. Wait, no longer needed? That can't be right. Because remember those jobs you were looking for? Those are really needed. And they're the stuff inside your stuff. Even inside that winter coat that moved with you to Phoenix. Our job is to unlock those jobs. And it starts when you donate your stuff to your local Goodwill. Here's how we do it. When you donate to Goodwill, we sell your stuff to provide job training for people right here in your community. So just by teaming up with Goodwill, you help create jobs. And isn't that worth parting with the leftover keytar from your 80s cover band? Goodwill. Donate stuff. Create jobs. Find your nearest donation center at goodwill.org. A message from Goodwill and the Ad Council.
I heard on the news about that 5-year-old who found his uncle's gun. The kid didn't know it was loaded.
I heard on the news about that 14-year-old girl who was bullied online. For like a year, she couldn't take it anymore, so she got her dad's gun from his nightstand.
I heard on the news about that guy who broke into someone's house, stole a gun from the hall closet.
He accidentally shot his cousin in the head.
She killed herself.
And later, killed the owner of the store he was trying to rob.
If you own a gun, you have a full-time responsibility. When you aren't using it, be sure it can't get into the hands of curious children, troubled teenagers, a thief, or anyone else who might misuse it. Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org. This message brought to you by the National Crime Prevention Council, the Bureau of Justice Assistance, and the Ad Council.
It takes 12 years to create a graduate. It takes about the same time to create a dropout. The difference between a child becoming one or the other could be you. Studies prove that reading to a child regularly dramatically improves reading skills. And kids who read well by third grade are 4 times as likely to graduate. So United Way is calling for 1 million volunteers over the next 3 years. We're asking you to step up, make a pledge, tutor a child who needs help, mentor a kid who needs someone on their side, volunteer to read to children, make a difference. Because when a child advances, we all advance. Entire communities improve. The path to success or failure starts long before graduation day. And the difference between a graduate and a dropout could be you. Be a reader, tutor, or mentor. Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United. Take the pledge. Go to liveunited.org now. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
While you're at work, Fido's working over the house, shredding newspapers and eating pillows. What can you do? Bonjour Dog Daycare could be the answer. With big and little dog playgroups, indoor and outdoor play yards, snack time and nap time, dogs leave tired. And a tired dog is a good dog. Call 571-CARE or log on to bonjour.org. Bonjour Dog Daycare, a good day for your dog.
Conversations with Suzanna is heard on the World Herald Live. I must tell you, the show off the air is just as exciting as on the air. We're talking, where do we go from here? There's so much about Dr. Luther King that we need to celebrate his life and his legacy, which is about peaceful terms, peaceful understanding. And one of the things that I love, and I love the fact that the understanding that, you know, when I saw the water hitting people, they were people.
And
you know, when we're growing up, we're thinking we're not, they're not, you know, we have different classes. We put everybody in. This is a Muslim. This is a Christian. This is, and we don't see the uniqueness of every individual to, in the capacity. And I'm going to let you start, Doctor. Tell me what you think. You want us to know, Reverend Kenneth, about Martin Luther King. What is the thing that means the most to you?
I think the thing that means the most to me is that he's a prime example of preparation and timing. He was intending to be a local pastor in Montgomery, Alabama, finish his dissertation, which he did, finish his dissertation, and live a quiet life as a local congregational leader. But then fate intervened, and I would say more specifically, God intervened. And Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on a bus in Montgomery, and out of that they launched the Montgomery bus boycott. And after the boycott,
which was brilliant in itself,
absolutely
brilliant. I mean, he did not go throw things at the buses.
No,
he just said you walk. Mm-hmm. I mean, brilliant. I wouldn't do it, but I'm not that courageous. But that was just brilliant. His whole aspect of being, you don't want this, you don't get our money.
And you say you wouldn't have done it, but when given the right circumstances and the right inspiration, one never knows what one might do, because
that's
I think
exactly
there were people
right.
who ordinarily would not have done that, but because of the strong leadership that he provided, along with the ministers and other community leaders,
and the motivation,
they were motivated to do that.
I mean, and it's to motivate Adele. What would you talked about earlier, that what you learned from Marten was. Go through it one more time, because it was profound.
What I had said earlier was walking in your mission and not questioning your mission. Make sure you have an understanding of what you are placed on this earth to do.
How is it that we find our mission, though? I mean, how do we not question our mission? I think that's probably something you're going to handle, Reverend. How is it that we don't know our mission, can understand the mission that he brought up, that we're here to do?
Well, I think Eric is right on target with that. Finding your mission in life is your primary goal in life. Understanding who you are and being authentic and true to who you are and to your calling. And each of us has a calling. It's not just those of us who are in the ministry, so to speak, but everyone has a calling. I'm going to be delivering a speech in the next few days on that very issue. It's almost as if Eric saw my notes, because I'm talking about the incredibly heavy burden of being yourself, of just being true to who you are. And so we go about that through a process of prayer and honestly interrogating our lives.
Questioning our lives.
Absolutely.
Questioning your lives, yes. For the greater good. Mm-hmm. I mean, and tell me what youth believe that they have been talking about.
I guess, well, to your first question about Dr. King, and I guess what I want people to kind of take from that, or what I take from that personally, is just that I think everybody has the ability to, you know, transform and make a difference in some capacity. And with regards to, you were talking about knowing, like, your passion and, mm-hmm. and know what it is that you're called to do. I mean, for me and my personal experiences, I just think, for one, it's going to take time. And then a series of events, and that could be, you know, trial and error, ups and downs, highs and lows. I think you then find, you know, like a happy medium through all of those experiences in life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Dr. Martin Luther King is a great, great example of that. We all have the power to be better. We all have the power to help others. Can you give us a quick rundown of what's going on at the campus?
Oh, definitely. Each year, Creighton University celebrates the life and legacy of Dr. King through a series of events, and typically those events are centered around his principles of nonviolence.
Love that nonviolence thing.
Okay. And this year's principle is nonviolence holds that voluntary suffering can educate and transform. And as Pastor Allen pointed out, the first kickoff to our events will be the teach-in on Saturday, January 16th. And that's going to be from 1 to 5 at the Creighton School of Law. So,
okay.
That event is open to the community, and you can go to Creighton's website. I believe it's /about/MLK, and you can see a series of events, which includes a viewing of the movie on the 17th. We have Courageous Voices, which is a discussion forum on Monday, January 18th. We then have a recognition and award ceremony, which is also the evening of Monday, January 18th as well.
And I do want everyone to understand that Dr. Martin Luther King is a gift to all of us. No matter what color your skin is, we all can learn from him and what he taught us. We'll be right back. This is Conversations with Suzanna, heard on the World Herald Live app and at omaha.com/Suzanna.
to the corner of Smith and Orchard, you're going to want to take a
You
left.
Are not going to
then
believe
what you're
this.
Do is turn
Marcy and Brad
Avenue
just broke up,
and, go past
and
the
apparently
first three
she's
lights,
happy about
and then
it.
Take the next left.
I don't really think she's happy, but
see,
who
there.
Am I to judge, right?
Park
anyway,
on the right.
That's
I'll
what I heard last
tonight.
Night.
It's hard to concentrate on two things at once, like texting and driving. Stop the text, stop the wrecks. How will you stop texting and driving? Tell us at StopTextStopWrecks.org. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
The Omaha World-Herald has immediate openings for full or part-time distribution positions in Omaha and in Dodge and Washington counties. The job duties include managing contractors and overseeing customer service. All you need is a valid driver's license and a reliable vehicle that is insured. Proof of insurance is required. The Omaha World-Herald offers competitive pay and benefits, including a 401k plan. Apply now at www.owh.com.
It takes 12 years to create a graduate. It takes about the same time to create a dropout. The difference between a child becoming one or the other could be you. Studies prove that reading to a child regularly dramatically improves reading skills, and kids who read well by third grade are four times as likely to graduate. So United Way is calling for 1 million volunteers over the next 3 years. We're asking you to step up, make a pledge, tutor a child who needs help, mentor a kid who needs someone on their side. Volunteer to read to children. Make a difference. Because when a child advances, we all advance. Entire communities improve. The path to success or failure starts long before graduation day. And the difference between a graduate and a dropout could be you. Be a reader, tutor, or mentor. Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United. Take the pledge. Go to liveunited.org now. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
When I grow up, I want to be a new pair of blue jeans.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's first computer.
When I grow up, I want to be a glass countertop in a new home.
When I grow up, I want to be a kid's best birthday present.
When I grow up, I want to be a football stadium.
When I grow up, I want to be a warm place on a cold day.
When I grow up, I want to be a fancy
bike. When I grow up, I want to be a bike that races around the country.
When I grow up, I want to be a bench on a forest trail.
I want to be a rocking chair on
when
a sunny
I grow up,
porch.
I want to be a skyscraper.
I want to be a...
I want to be a...
I want to be...
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 When I grow up, I don't want to be a piece of garbage. And if you recycle me, I won't be.
Give your garbage another life. Recycle. Learn how at iwanttoberecycled.org. A public service advertisement brought to you by Keep America Beautiful and the Ad Council.
Today, my new dad and I shot off a rocket in the park.
Today, my new son and I failed to shoot off a rocket.
He knew exactly what to do.
I have no clue what I was doing.
We set up the rocket.
We set up the rocket.
Hit ignition.
Hit ignition.
And then?
And then nothing. Sometimes I laugh when I'm frustrated.
Then out of nowhere, the rocket launched into the air.
The rocket did get into the air.
I've never seen anything fly so high.
And then crashed into a kite.
Look out! Look out!
And then the pond.
I'll never forget that day.
I'll never forget that day, even if I tried.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are. For more information on how you can adopt, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt U.S. Kids, and the Ad Council.
I heard on the news about that 5-year-old who found his uncle's gun. The kid didn't know it was loaded.
I heard on the news about that 14-year-old girl who was bullied online. For like a year, she couldn't take it anymore. So she got her dad's gun from his nightstand.
I heard on the news about that guy who broke into someone's house, stole a gun from the hall closet.
He accidentally shot his cousin in the head.
She killed herself.
And later, killed the owner of the store he was trying to rob.
If you own a gun, you have a full-time responsibility. When you aren't using it, be sure it can't get into the hands of curious children, troubled teenagers, a thief, or anyone else who might misuse it. Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org. This message brought to you by the National Crime Prevention Council, the Bureau of Disassistance, and the Ad Council.
Are exactly where you need to be. This has been a very exciting show, and if you're online watching it, you'll see the characters in the studio changed. Oh yes, we're always constantly changing, constantly moving about, because this show is about giving you all the information you could possibly need. And we're going to start with the girl on the right. We have between us, if you'll introduce yourself first, Reverend, your name is?
Yes, I'm Kenneth Allen, pastor of Zion Baptist Church in North Omaha.
Okay.
42nd and Grant Street.
Okay, and you're?
I'm Andrea Kusiniak, or the paper.
Okay, and what do you do for the paper, Andrea?
For nightlife mostly, but I also do community events and stuff like that.
Okay, marvelous. And Andrea, and how long have you worked for the paper?
Almost 3 years.
3 years, and what did you do before you wrote for the Omaha World-Herald?
I went to college.
You went to college?
My first job, yeah.
Your first job,
mm-hmm.
And your job is to scope the town, see what's happening, and move through that. There, you're here to tell us what's happening on Martin Luther King Day.
Yeah, we have a list of events that we're running.
Okay, let's talk about that.
Okay, what do you want to know?
And tell us everything that's going to be happening.
It's a really long list. So Creighton is having.
Well, we've talked to Creighton,
so I don't know who you've talked to. So Creighton's having a thing. There's a lot of church things.
Tell me about the church things.
Well, St. Matthew Lutheran is having a thing on Sunday to honor Martin Luther King. I guess they're going to feature music by Duke Ellington during their 10:30 a.m. service.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also going to be music from their director and their soloist. So that's something that we're featuring. They're going to show Selma at Creighton at 7, so I guess you already know that. And then Salem Baptist is having a Martin Luther King service at 6.
And actually, that's sponsored by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance.
Tell us who that's sponsored by, baby.
That's sponsored by the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance. We refer to it as the IMA. And the IMA is composed of pastors and clergy from various denominations, Lutherans, Roman Catholics, Baptists.
So it's not by the color of your skin that you're there.
Not by the color of your skin. It is a fully integrated group.
It's by the color of your heart.
That's right, and the content of your character.
That's exactly right. What else do we have, Andrea?
There's an event at House of Loom, which is actually, it's like a bar and nightclub on Saturday, which seems really cool. It's going to be a tribute to Martin Luther King, and they're going to have poetry by Michelle Troxclair, who does lots of, she does like Verbal Gumbo, which is a poetry event for them. And her poetry is going to be inspired by Coretta King. Martin Luther King's wife. And there's also going to be music performances. Derek Higgins is going to be there. Stuff like that. So it's just going to be a full night of celebrations. And I think it starts at 8 and runs till 2 a.m.
Now, is there a place in the paper we can go to see all of these lists?
So Go is a resource, and that's in Thursday in the paper.
Thursday.
Yeah, and then Community Connection. Well, it's Good News now, sorry. And we have the Good News section, which is, so we have church notes, community events, things like that that go in there.
Okay, so you'll want to check the Omaha World Herald.
Yes, you will.
For Thursday.
And our big list of Martin Luther King events, I believe, is running this Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I want to thank you for coming in.
Yeah.
And then we're going to go back to you, Reverend.
Okay.
And I'm going to let you end up the show and telling us what you want us to experience from Martin Luther King.
That is a wonderful question. I want us to experience the man in his greatness, but also in his complexity. He's not a cardboard figure. He has a unique position in America. He's the only person other than a United States president who has a holiday set aside in his honor.
And a Nobel Prize.
Nobel Peace Prize.
Nobel Peace Prize.
Yes, indeed.
And that was quite an accomplishment in his day and age.
Yes, it was. He was one of the youngest ever to receive a Nobel Prize. And it was a remarkable accomplishment because he was not an office holder. He did not have a position at one of the great universities in the world. He was a man who was committed and dedicated to his cause and to his mission, and that propelled him to the front ranks of world history.
Marvelous, marvelous. The Martin Luther King Day is going to be January 15th, is that correct? Is that his birthday?
That's his actual birthday, but the annual holiday is the third Monday in January. Every year it's the third Monday in January.
Why is it the third Monday and not his birthday?
It's not on his birthday because Congress chose to make it a day that could be celebrated in conjunction with a free weekend, and as they do with Memorial Day and a number of other holidays.
So I would suggest that everyone needs to get involved and take a look and see what is there for us on Martin Luther King Day. This day is a day of inspiration. And what I want to take for you is the inspiration of Dr. Martin Luther King. And what is it you do at your church? Tell me about the name of the church again. What does Zion mean? I don't know what Zion means.
Zion Baptist Church is the name of the church, and Zion was a biblical name for Jerusalem. The mountain on which Jerusalem was located was Mount Zion. So in virtually every community in America of any size, you will find either a Zion Baptist Church or a Mount Zion Baptist Church. Both of them were interchangeable with the name, the city of Jerusalem.
Well, and I'll be honest with you, when I hear Zion, I think Jew.
Yes.
And Christ was
a
Jew.
Yes.
So, okay,
it all falls
together now. Thank you for being here.
Does. May I say something?
Yes.
I just want to say thank you, Suzanna, for having us on today to talk about the Martin Luther King events.
It's a beautiful.
Thank you.
I mean, I'm so proud of his courage. I pray that we all have courage to be our best and not harm each other.
Yes.
Andrea, I'm going to have you back in the studio.